Number 64, and the $64,000 question is, turn to Romans chapter 6. And I want to try sorting some things out if possible. All these classes in Romans are important, but this class and the next one will be given to trying to sort out what we've discussed, particularly in relationship to our death and our weakness. You know, it is possible, and I know this because I was a Bible school student once, it is possible to sit in classes and hear things and really think you have them. And you assume you do because what you got out of it, you understand. Does that make sense? I mean, you know, and you did get something out of it. But it may not be what the person is trying to communicate, and more than that, it may not be what the Holy Spirit's trying to communicate. But each of us are in different places. But there's a basic pattern, there's a basic path that God has laid down, an ancient path that involves certain things that are always true, because the thing that makes the path ancient is it's God, it's his nature, it's the way that he operates, it's who he is and how he brings things about. And if we don't get that, which by the way, that was our first couple of classes, we really laid that out. But if we don't get that, then it's just a bunch of theology, I guess. And theology never changed anybody. The theology of Jesus never changed anybody. Only Jesus changes somebody. And he not only changes them, but he is the change. He is the change. So I know we're familiar with, and for those of you on Skype, if you're not able to read this from a distance, our death, our death, our death, our death, our weakness, and our weakness. I want to talk about these. And in talking about it this class, I would like for you to help me apply it in the next class. Okay? So that would require what? Well, you start with listening. Yeah. And if you listen, hopefully there'll be enough given that it will help you to start moving things into place as it's seen by God and as it is in heaven. It'll be in earth as it is in heaven, in him. The first, our death, I think is basically understood by most of us simply because there's enough scripture. And there's more scripture than I think we even realize that just comes out and says that our death is our death is with Christ. Okay, well, good, praise God. Woohoo! That really doesn't mean anything unless we're dead with Christ. I don't mean theological, I don't mean that it's something he did 2,000 years ago. I mean, are we dead with Christ? You know, if we're not dead with Christ, then that's a scary thing that someone could get hold of It's like a rod with no power. So we wield it the way that we want to, and then it becomes our power. Or just because we think we understand the doctrine of it, or that just the scripture saying that I'm crucified with Christ, or know you not that, you know, you're dead, can give us a false sense of eternal truth. I mean, see, this area, all of these areas, should never be approached with unholy hands. What do I mean by that? I don't mean that you're sinless and perfect. I mean that your motive is to gain the Lord at any cost and never stop. You know, we're singing that song. How's it go, Scott? Relentless, something like that. Pardon? You won't relent until you have it all. And of course, have it all is Jesus, because he's all and in all. You know, we've been around for a long time as a church. And I hope we're just not now starting to be relentless. Because that would just, you know, I mean, I'm teetering right now. I don't need to know that, you know. I was talking to somebody recently, and I said, you know, one reason why I think I came to a revelation of Christ so early is, number one, I didn't get saved because I didn't want to go to hell. I didn't get saved because I was afraid of the consequences. I was from Oak Cliff. You know, you don't live in Oak Cliff and worry about consequences, you know what I mean? You just do. But I got saved because of things that I saw in my life, that being a hippie, and I thought that philosophy or whatever, you know, peace and all this stuff and love and all that was going to change the world, and it didn't, and it didn't even change me. And then I went up with people for a couple of years in the international cast, travel around with the goody goods of the best. I mean, I thought, this is going to rub off on me. Well, I got news for you. I rubbed off on them. We won't talk about how. But anyway, I came out of there just, you know, not knowing what to do. And anyway, so when I came to the Lord, I felt hope beyond what I felt with the hippie movement and up with people and stuff like that. It was an inward Jesus. It was an inward peace. It was an inward, and I believed that there was hope. Well, when I went to Berea and started going to Bible school, they started talking about death with Christ. And when I didn't see any proof of that, when I say proof, I mean, if it says, you know, this is going to happen, if you're dead, then you'll walk in newness of life, and like Colossians describes what that's like. Mortify your deeds which are upon the earth, da 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 da. And so I'm believing in the cross, but I'm not seeing it. Okay, well, there's a certain embrace of that, folks, until you see it. But there's also just a cold, hard fact that there are a whole lot of people that just keep embracing the fact without any unrelenting pressure forward that Christ be formed in them without any doubt. Doubtless, you know, because it is Christ and you know it, and people around you begin to know it. And that was my deal. It's like, why stop? Why go, well, you know, I'm doing better. I don't want to do better. I want Jesus. I want to be dead. You know? Some of y'all old-timers around here remember the book I wrote, the little leaflet on suicide. Anybody remember that book? See? And I was a good one to help write that. I had a girl who was always trying to commit suicide, and she sat down with me. But I was, because I just wanted to die, But I knew just suicide wasn't it, so I wasn't thinking about suicide. So I would, you know, before I came to the Lord, I would do insane things. Just crazy and not afraid at all. You know, if I die, that might do the world some good or something. But when I found the word talking about our death, that was like tremendous news to me. It wasn't like, oh, well, I'll add that to my little collection of doctrines. And, you know, and I'll worship that, but I won't let it touch me. I won't let it have a hold upon me. No, that my idea was, if this doesn't work, I don't know where I'm going to go. But I knew that, you know, your spirit bears witness with the word and with the Lord. I'm born again. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. And anything that kept showing up in me that wasn't that just made me madder to go after the Lord. Because it was, to me, it was almost like something mocking the word of God, mocking the Lord. And you know, I don't personally claim perfection on any level, but I know it's like Paul said, but I press towards the mark of the prize, the high calling, which is in Christ. And I do, and I have, and I will. And I know many of you feel exactly the same way. And if there's been a lull or a letdown, it's time to be not recharged or revived. It's time to get the Lord in real ways. It's time to stop any justifying. And see, the human psyche is amazing because it has found a way to justify without taking responsibility. It's called temporary amnesia. Yeah. Well, I find we remember what we want to remember. Yeah. Well, it's temporary now and then temporary a few minutes later or an hour and the next day or whatever. Anyway, so there's our death with Christ, but it's also our death to the old nature. Okay. Well, folks, can we claim a death with Christ without claiming a death of the old nature? I mean, I think, you know, I mean, we're magically here in Romans 6. And verse 3 says, know ye not? Don't you know? Don't you know this? This is Paul. Know ye not? It's almost as if he's a little appalled. Don't you know this? Know ye not that as many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? Okay, so there he starts setting the stage and saying, you know, the first thing most people do when they get saved is get baptized. That's not true of everybody, but it's true of a lot of people because a lot of churches bring that forward pretty quick. If you got saved, let's go get baptized. The Ethiopian eunuch in the chariot, remember that? Philip's ministering to him and leads him to the Lord and says, you know, they say, is there any water here? And he goes, there's some right there, let's do it. So he didn't go, well, I'm gonna try to get deep. Well, I'll get you deep. No, from the very beginning they say, okay, you may not understand this, but when you go down, that's your death, and when you come up, that's new life, that's Christ. And from now on, shoot for that. I mean, does that make sense? I mean, how many of us have ever thought back to our water baptism and says, I'm still pressing toward to grasp that thing from which was my beginning. I want to have that realized in my being. Most of us know, oh, I got wet. And we move on. Know ye not? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death. Like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, how many of us embrace, how many of us hug the part here that says, like as Christ, not that part, like as Christ was raised from the dead, not that part, by the glory of the Father. And I mean, I don't mean it made God happy that his dead son got up. That's not it. We'll deal with that just real shortly here. Even so, we should walk in newness. Even so, if Jesus, you know, if we went down with Jesus into death and God raised him from the dead, we're going to walk in new life. All right. Well, you know, I think a lot of Christians embrace that on this level. It's not walking in new life. It's walking in a new way of them living. It's still them. There's no real death. And there's no real life that is the resurrection that is Christ. It is them living the Christian life for God. And, might I say, all that try that fail. You know why? Because it's not Christ. Because you can't do it. And even if you did everything Christ did in the Christian life, he still wouldn't like it because he put Jesus in you because he wanted Jesus out of you. Does that make sense? Okay. All right, so okay. Our death, the problem was, I've been chewing on this for a while, and I just got, as soon as I got here, I went in and said, I need to chart this, you know. Okay. Our death, okay, this is a death after there is a reality of your old man being crucified, or after the reality that you're dead with Christ in relationship to a new nature. This death, this our death, is, and I'm going to put it this way, is not a death at all. It's a dying. Okay. Well, are we dead or not? Well, that's a good question. Ask yourself that. The scripture talk about bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus. So in reality, it's not really our death. We are bearing his death. Where are we bearing it out? We're bearing it about in our bodies, the dying of the Lord Jesus. Okay? What is that? 2 Corinthians 4:10? Yes. So that we recognize that there's a dying going on in relationship to us, not just a death, but a dying going on. But then we have to recognize that we're bearing about his dying. And this is, the word dying is an ing word. It's an ongoing. It's not a done, dead, past tense. For you're dead, past tense. Dying. All right. So, all right. So let's move on to the weakness part. Our weakness What is that? And how does that fit in with any of this? Okay? Our weakness is lack. It's our lack. That this first weakness here, we got two of them listed. Our weakness is our lack. Okay? I mean, just your lack. Do you lack anything? Are you perfect in yourself? No, you lack. Some of you lack. Never mind. Yeah. Yes. That's not what I was going to say, but thank you, John, for smiling, because that we need the body of Christ. Every one of us are aware of our lack on certain levels. Many times, the way to, you know, this is the way they teach to be successful. This isn't the right words, but it's focus on your strengths, not your weaknesses. So you put all your energy toward what you're good at, and you avoid being put in situations where you lack, because you'll look stupid. This is why you never see, like, intellectuals becoming circus clowns for a living. One, okay. Circus clowns, not jugglers. Jugglers are still showing off ability. I don't know if that's a good example or not. But the idea being that you intentionally avoid your weaknesses. Therefore, now consider this. What if God wanted you to do something that would involve your lack? In other words, I want you in an area where there is going to show up your lack. Would you say yes to God, or would you say no? Like that. That's right. Or? Or having six kids when you don't like it and being told to teach the children in the conference. Yeah. But, you know, we avoid these things because we have only one thought. Ourselves, because we don't really, really, really believe we're dead. You know, understand, you couldn't. Okay. And the other thing is we don't want to look bad. You know, I was going to say, what was it I said? How was that? I worded it about, I can't remember when I first said it. But I said, well, you know, something like, what would we do if God asked us to be involved in an area where we are lacking? Would we do what he said? And the thought actually that came to me, and I believe from the Holy Spirit, was, it depends. This is us now responding to him. It depends. Well, it depends on what? Well, it depends on how many people are going to see me involved in this, especially people that I don't want to, think bad of me. I don't, but if it's a situation of my lack and nobody's going to see it, I would probably be willing. You see, I mean, this is, folks, this is a constant thing. Our minds, everything, weighing everything in relationship to us, how we look, how we appear, what we're going to do, what we're going to not do. It is automatic, and it's quicker than you can realize that you think that way. You don't even realize it. No, I'm not going to do that. Or is anybody else going to be? No, I'll do it. And then, everyone should rejoice because I'm laying down my life. When in actuality, you're actually covering your life. Okay. So, So weakness, the first one is our lack. The second weakness is, I'm sure people on Skype can't see this too well because we're getting low here. The first weakness, our weakness, is lack. The second weakness is faith. Anybody know what faith we're talking about?
Yes.
If you don't, I'm going to take you out back and beat you with an ugly stick. I'm Skype. I'm joking. I don't beat people. Well, not people outside of myself. What if we never saw a difference between our lack and the weakness? Anybody remember last week when I taught on the weakness stuff? We went through a bunch of scriptures and showed an incredible reality that could make you free. The truth would actually do that. I mean, really? Okay, so if you didn't get that class, not that you might have been here and not got it, then you don't really know what I'm talking about when I say there's a weakness that comes by walking by faith or living by faith. And all of those scriptures and more that I read, every one of them, definitively, they lay it out that this is what it's saying. And if we miss that, and we just apply everything to our weakness, oh, we're in trouble. We're in trouble. All right, so let me read a little bit here, and then maybe at the end we'll start applying the weakness. But I want you to listen very carefully. This subtitle, which is probably what we'll call this, but you don't have to, you can jot it down. Death brings about a certain kind of life. Death brings about a certain kind of life. Death brings about a certain kind of life. We have spent a lot of time on the kind of death it would take that would only bring forth life. Anybody remember that? We said there's a kind of death that only brings forth life. Okay, well, we spent 63 classes pretty much dealing with that. But if you get that, then you don't have to worry about what kind of life. It'll be the right kind of life. But if you don't get it, you at least ought to know what kind of life you should be living. So I'm going to give it to you. While we have plainly stated up to this point that resurrection requires a specific kind of death, let it now be understood that resurrection demands that it be a specific kind of life. Resurrection demands that it be a specific kind of life, or guess what? It's not resurrection. At least not in God's book. I mean, you know. Let's just say that I say it's not resurrection because it's, in my mind, the only thing that counts is the way God thinks. Okay, I mean, that's. But then we go, okay, well, what about Lazarus? Lazarus was resurrected. You know, so see, smarty, that wasn't. Okay, yeah. Lazarus was resurrected, and he wasn't resurrected, and it wasn't unto a certain kind of life. But that's really not resurrection in God's mind. And as I said, I don't try to think through stuff. I try to find the mind of Christ. What if my weakness was, well, I can't think through stuff? You know, I remember when I was teaching the clients at Denton State School. My first job there, I had three different jobs there. And I had a classroom full of mentally handicapped kids. And I'd been in the ministry, I'd been a missionary, everything else, and now the ranch burns down and I'm having to get a job, and I'm sitting there and I'm going, Lord, I can't even evangelize these kids. They can't even mentally handle it. And he said, so you think that receiving Jesus is a mental thing? And I said, well, what? What you said? And I thought about it, I thought, oh my God. I mean, it really did liberate me. Anyway, I started praying for the kids and everything. And they started coming to the Lord left and right. It was so precious. And they really got the Lord. You could see changes in them and stuff. It was really great. But it also then made me realize that smart people don't have anything on mentally handicapped people when it comes to the Lord. In fact, the smart people could end up being the dumb people. Well, and the scriptures talk about that. They talk about that. Especially in the eyes of the Lord. And see, do you ever notice how I keep going back in the eyes of the Lord or in the mind of the Lord? Because if you get to a place where the only thing that matters is his mind or the way he sees things, you get to that place and all this wandering stops. Your eye is single, you know. The wandering stops, the figuring out, the confusion, the this, the that. You go, look, you know, and it also just remedies everything in your head in this sense. Well, what if da-da-da-da? And then you say, the Holy Spirit doesn't have to say it back. Eventually you get where you go, that doesn't matter. Let's just find out what's the mind of the Lord. Well, what about this? You know, we ain't talking about it. We're seeking the Lord. All right. It is not just that we had a life, but then we died. But resurrection now brings a reliving. See that? You have a life, you die, you get up. That's what a lot of people think happened with Jesus. He had a life, he died, he got up. Resurrection is not merely life in contrast to being dead. Okay, it's not. And I would say the average Christian, that's their definition. That's all they need to have. They haven't sought beyond that. What is it here? Resurrection is merely life in contrast to being dead. I was dead, but now I have resurrection. Or I will be dead, but then one day I'll have resurrection. That's all I need to know. Okay. But if that was all you need to know, I mean, if nothing else, why in the heck would there be a 1 Corinthians 15? Resurrection is unto a new life. Resurrection is unto a new life, which will also result in a change as to how we walk. And that's verse 4 that we read right here, Romans 6, 4. Therefore, we are buried by baptism into death, that as Christ was raised up from the dead, we walk in newness of life, or new life. Okay. So that's the, you know, I've said this before, but that's the explanation that Paul's giving in this verse of resurrection. A new life, and he calls it Christ raised. Okay. Y'all have heard me say that many times, so I'm sure that you have that down so cleanly and clearly that it's pure waters from the fountain of heaven. We're to walk in newness of life, or a new life. It is a certain kind of life that only comes out of death. Okay, so we think we know what that means. It's a certain kind of life that only comes out of death, okay? In fact, the life, and I have it capitalized here, in fact, the life that gave itself unselfishly is the life that God raised in order to exalt it. Ah. Y'all got this right?
Most of you going,
no, I didn't write it down. It's not really important to my life. All right, let's see. You got God. You got Jesus on the cross. And you got the Lamb on the throne. This cushion's a little wompy. All right, so God looks at a certain kind of death and sees it at Calvary. He sees what the only kind of death that was worth anything. It was pure selflessness. Okay? He sees that, and he sees the value of that. And since it's the only thing in all of his creation that has it, he sees it and then he exalts it to the highest position that at the name of Jesus, okay, so here's the deal. You see, from the chart here, you see God here to the side, you see the cross at the bottom where Jesus died, you see the throne at the top where he was raised to, and you see the arrows coming from God first seeing the Lamb give himself when he didn't deserve the depth of what he went through, but he did it for God and others. He sees that, and then second, he exalts that to the highest throne. Okay, we can see that we can acknowledge that, right? Okay, but here's the key. One more arrow. What was crucified is also what was raised. The crucified nature, the selfless nature, is what he exalted to the throne and said, everybody bow to this. He didn't just, you know, we say, well, the death was really bad, but praise God, God overcame death. Well, yeah, but you know what? All of our concepts of him overcoming death really just masks the scriptural understanding that death was the way that he brought about everything. He overcame bringing about everything and this being the whole thing, the bomb that exploded and brought it all about. He overcame that. No, that's what overcame everything. The resurrection didn't overcome it. He just exalted him because he laid down his life, and that selflessness brought it about. And he raised it, and we have to see that crucified, suffering, bleeding Lamb is sitting on that throne. Does that make sense? That's what's exalted. All right, I'm really trying to cover a bunch of stuff real quick here, so. It is a certain kind of life that only comes out of death. In fact, the life that gave itself unselfishly is the life that God raised in order to exalt it. I exalt this Lamb. I don't change him from being a lamb. I don't take away his scars or his blood or any of that stuff. I exalt that stuff. I glory in those scars. You glory in the fact that you do everything and put on stuff to hide your scars. No offense. But God's not ashamed. We're ashamed. And we're ashamed because our thinking is just the opposite of this. We want death to take everything bad away instead of us be the one taking everything bad into us for others. We're just, We're not in the image of God. And in fact, it's questionable if we know God, if we really know God. And unless if we, you know, gosh, we just have so little time here. But God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And it is this constant self-giving and acknowledging one another. And it's going around every different, and it's cutting across. And it's always selfless to acknowledge the other. That's God. That's the Trinity. We say, well, there's three of them. I know God. There's three of them. They're not three gods. There's one, and this is the way God works, in oneness. Okay, oneness isn't sameness. They're not the same, are they? Oneness isn't sameness. Oneness is of one nature. The two shall become one nature, but they're still two with one nature, but still two, but not two, one. But bride and groom. All right, so that life that came forth out of death is the new life we are to walk in and live by. That is what we're supposed to walk in and live by. I'm pointing to the cross. Death must become our tool in order to obtain a certain kind of life. Okay? Because that life gave himself in death, and he only offers it to us through his death. We are baptized into his death. You want to be with me? Be with me first in death. Show me that you're with me in what's important to me. No. I'm doing this so I can get into resurrection. I didn't say you came up. I said you might be in me. But I didn't say you came up, and you certainly were not resurrected. You might rise, but you're not resurrected. He's resurrected, and you're in him. Don't call the fact that you rise with him resurrection, because resurrection is a certain kind of life, and you're just making it a doctrinal theology of how to go up higher and get out of stuff. To obtain this new life will cause you to accept this proposition of death. You will, if you want that kind of life, it's Lamb life on the throne. You have to accept the proposition that you're going to have to bear about the dying. Gosh, I guess I shouldn't have raised all that stuff. Am I right or wrong? He says, I bear about the dying of the Lord Jesus. He didn't say I bear about the dying of Jesus of Nazareth on a cross. This is present dying, and it's the Lord Jesus, the one exalted, that's on that throne. But the one on that throne is a lamb. Seen how? You bear about the crown of the, you know, like people say, well, I'm a king's kid. What's the attitude behind that? You're not a king's kid. Jesus is the king, and you're not his kid. And all the attitude that goes with that, well, I'm a king's kid, you know? How about, you know, I started to say about my brother's a carpenter. You know, but it just doesn't have the ring to it, does it? My brother's a, you know, yeah. My brother's a Jewish criminal. You know, my life is a Jewish criminal. What? You know, we don't want to go there. We don't want anything to do with Jesus. The true Jesus. We only want what has been exalted. And I'm not talking about the Lamb on the throne. I'm talking about some sort of exalted, glorious overcomer. Folks, overcomer. Come on. They overcame them by the blood of the Lamb, not by the sword in the hand of the risen King. By the word of their testimony, and because they love not their lives, and that's how you overcome. Anyway, I'm sorry I believe in this so strongly. It is a death to our works and efforts. while at the same time a reliance on the life of resurrection. Okay, it's a death to our works and efforts. Okay, that's the death of the old man. Our death, remember? Our death. I'm sure you got the chart in front of you. Our death to the old nature. Okay, so it is that that's included. It's a death to our works and efforts, while at the same time a reliance on the life of resurrection, which is our death in terms of bearing about the dying of the Lord Jesus. You have to see it. If you don't see it, I'm just going to be honest with you. If you don't see it, then you need to get after it. I mean, I remember, you know, many a times, and it hadn't ended yet, but when I hear something, or I heard, even in all the way back to Bible school to now, if I hear something that I go, oh my God, this could be eternal. I got to know this. You know, I said stuff like, I belong to Jesus. I'm going to belong to him my whole life. I need to get it. I need to, you know, even when I didn't understand the fullness of that, I was like, I got to get this. And none of that said, I'm going to be a minister. I got to get this. None of that. It was all, you know, I'm a follower of Jesus. I need to kind of get what he's saying. You know, turns around with the cross and says, except you deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. And then, you know, they don't know that he is the cross. He is bearing the cross even then to Calvary. That's what got him to Calvary. It's that spirit. And these guys are, hey, we're following Jesus while he's bearing the cross. No comprehension, no hunger, no, I must have this Jesus. And I'm telling you, there's a whole great portion of scriptures you're never going to understand if you don't understand our death, old nature, and our death bearing about the dying of the Lord Jesus. Because one is in death at the cross, and the other one is in resurrection, bearing the one who's dying. Two different things. Please tell me we started a little late. Good. You no longer seek to live unto God based solely on how you order your external ways. I'm going to live unto God. I'm going to order my ways. I'm going to read a Bible. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. I thought you were supposed to be bearing about the risen one in you, which has nothing to do with your mentality. It has nothing to do with your choices. In fact, Jesus described it to Peter. He says, well, when you get old, meaning when you get mature, other people are going to carry you around places you don't want to go, but that's going to be you laying down your life, bearing about my dying. And they said, and this spoke what manner of death that he would die, you know, how he was going to die. What? Okay. Well, we say, well, I'm committed to Jesus. Well, first of all, are you? And second of all, if you are, then you need to understand what he calls commitment. You no longer seek to live unto God based solely upon how you order your external ways. You live unto God by Jesus Christ, Romans 6:11. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ. You don't just reckon yourself dead. It doesn't say reckon yourself dead, period. It says reckon yourself dead unto sin. That's death, our death to the old nature, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ. What's the life that God raised and gave to us? Again, Lamb of God. Okay, the promise of Galatians 3:21, which we can turn there rather briskly. Galatians 3:21. Is it 3:21? I've got 3:21 here. I think it's 2:21. Yeah. I do not make void the grace of God. For if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. He says, don't make void the grace of God. Okay, so we go, well, I don't. I believe that God's going to save my selfish, self-centered life that I'm living for Him, covering it over and making it look spiritual. And I believe that the grace of God, I don't make void the grace of God. He said, you just made it void. The verse in front of this is, I'm crucified with Christ. I'm crucified with Christ. Okay. Crucified. With Christ. Okay. Galatians 2:20. I crucified with Christ. Remember our very first, our death? Our death was with Christ. The second one was just a reiteration of that to remind us it's death to the old nature. Our death is death to the old nature. Okay? So the first one in Galatians 2:20, the one that we all know, I am crucified with Christ. Okay, so I'm dead. I'm dead. I'm just dead. I'm dead to the old nature. I'm dead to the law. That's what he said in the verse before Galatians 2:20. Verse 19, he's showing that death covers it all. I, dead. Okay? I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Okay? So there's a living going on. In other words, you didn't just die and it's over. You died to the old nature, but nevertheless you live, okay? But now we have to grasp what he's talking about, I live. So he says, well, this living that I do now is not I. I'm crucified, dead in the old nature. Nevertheless, I live. But I am living, but it's not I, not this I, not this one up here that is crucified with Christ. I live, but it's not this I up here. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but it is Christ. What does that mean? Because see, up here, I am crucified with Christ, but it hasn't explained yet the life, the resurrection. I'm dead. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but it's not I that was crucified with Christ. I'm done. Christ not just died to put me to death. I'm crucified with Christ. Christ lives in me, okay? So this crucified with Christ, that's the dead Christ. That's the one on the cross. Can I get an amen? That's Jesus of Nazareth, if you will, but it's taking us all there. But this is not I. Christ lives in me. This is the resurrected Christ. This is the nature of the Lamb that was on the cross that accomplished this first I's death is now living in me. So what's the result of that going to be? Not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life I now live. Isn't this fun? Isn't it? It's just as fun as it can be. And the not I, but Christ lives in me. And so the life that I now live, this is like a different I. It's like this one died. This one's Christ. This is what's living in me. I now live. Not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life I now live in the flesh is a faith life. The life I live in the flesh, right here, that you see, isn't just Jesus behind my skin. Just, he's so here that he's just making my eyes bulge out. As if, you know, no. He lives in us. He lives in me. It's not I, but there is a me. He lives in me, but he's the life. Okay? But I now live in the flesh. Don't you see me? But the life that you see is not Randy's life up here that started, I am crucified. It's not my selfish existence. It's not my preferences. It's not everything that I ever wanted. It is now a life of faith by the Son of God. By the faith of the Son of God. I'm living a life according and in tune with the faith of the Son of God that loves by giving himself for us. Amen. This is my life. This is what you see. This is the way I think. I'm just trying to paint. Let this mind be in you. This is Philippians right there. We could do the same thing with Philippians. We could. Philippians 2. What is it? 5 through 11. We could do the same thing. It's an ancient path. It's an ancient path. It is the thing that we've been talking about this whole 64 classes. So the promise of Galatians 2:21 is not just life, but life according to Galatians 2:20. A self-giving life. For us, the promise of that life only comes through death, Galatians 2:20. This death is not just a death to the old nature, but comes about because we have a new nature. The life I now live in the flesh. Not I, but Christ lives in me. And it is a lamb nature. That's the life that I now live in the flesh. And that, folks, that's what we're supposed to be living in the flesh. I don't care about all the doctrine that goes, you know, from here up in Galatians 2:20, it doesn't matter how much you claim you're crucified with Christ. It doesn't matter how much you claim Christ lives in you. The only thing that matters is if this upper part of Galatians 2:20 is true, then there will be a life that you live in the flesh, and it won't be you. It will be your faith by his life. No, because we're over right now. Sorry, but it's okay. Let me make sure I got this last part. And the life that comes to us is one that embraces death as its way of gaining and giving life. In other words, it doesn't gain by gain. It gains by losing. And it knows it, and it lives by that faith because it lives by that nature. We walk by faith. We walk in such a way that new life comes out of our death, our bearing about the dying. Our death, our bearing about the dying. See, we're past our death, the old man, Romans 6. We're past that. Romans 12 doesn't go back. He's ready to roll on to the end of the book with a new look, I mean, if I was you, if I was sitting out there and I heard this, I'd be thinking, man, I cannot wait for this class to be over. I'm going to start digging into the rest of it. I'm going to see this ancient path. I'm going to get hold of the Lord in this way. And I'm not only that, I'm going to know the Lord's heart. I'm going to know the book. I'm going to be able, if somebody asks me something, I'm going to be able to point them there. Some of you are looking at me like, well, I wasn't planning on doing that. Okay. All right, so our last class, which is shortly, I want to, and maybe we should make our break a little short, but the next class, I want to kind of go over some of these things. I definitely want to go over the two weaknesses, and I want to show that in light of all that we're talking here, I mean, doesn't Galatians 2:20 look like a math problem? With an answer, not a right math problem, a math answer. and to try for us to see if we can nail down some things in our thinking so that the order of our minds is not based on what we know, but it's not our mind, it's the mind of Christ. And if we don't have that mind, we'll always think the way we think. And anytime the Holy Spirit brings something up and goes, da-da-da-da, what about this? And we go, oh, my, I never think of that, or da-da-da, it's never even occurred to me, or whatever. Where is the gumption? Where is the desire that says, you know, but I'm going to have you, Jesus? But it's like, no, I'm in Bible school. I'll get it at the end. No, trust me, ask some Bible school students if you get it at the end, you know. Yes, you do. All right, let's take a break and we'll come back. And I may need all this.